a guten Tag teil de Tmimim. Mir jetzt ist schon now we're going to be Mamshech with Hilchas Hagalos Kelim and Yonim that we didn't finish yet. We were speaking about the gas wrench, how to kasha the stovetop and the grates and so on and so forth. What we failed to mention was what's doing with the hood, that it's on top of the gas wrench and the wall behind it and so on. So the halacha is as follows. There is a machaber in Yeredeya, in Siman Tzadik Beis, it says, Machvas shel cholof, shenosna bekira tachas kedelin shel basar. You have a frying pan, a milchige, but you put it underneath, in a tanner, underneath a kededa which has basar. Hazeya oile, the heat, the steam goes up, the nivla begededa, and it's nivla in the upper kededa, v'asrasa, and it asers it. This is a klore machaber. But what's doing with the bottom one? The machaber doesn't discuss that. Is the bottom one, does the bottom one become asr or not? So this is a machlekes achreinim. The Dogel Marvava, the Priteir, they say it becomes asr because the zeya actually connects them. And the same way the upper one becomes asr because the zeya of the milchige goes up, it makes a connection and it comes down as well. The Primigodim writes, it is only asr if the zeya is chizeres v'yeredes l'machvas. In other words, you see droplets, it condensation and it falls back down, something like that. And in the Sefer Piskei Adma Razakin, which is from the Kaplans, from Bar Yalit Kaplan, so they write that from the Alter Rebbe's Mashma, like the shit of the Dogel Marvava, because the Havel itself, is mechabroi, it makes it a chibur in Azeya, it's ki'ilu, both things are mixed up. They bring a raya from the Lashon from the Alter Rebbe in Siman Tov Nun Aleph, in Sif Mem Aleph, and later on in Sif Samaches. So, that if you cook a pot on Pesach, and the hood on top of it is not covered, and a lot of zeya goes up, and it's yatzei ledes, it's very hot. So according to the Alter Rebbe, according to the Dogel Marvava, it is mechaber right away the pot with that, and it becomes asr, which is a very interesting halacha, and many people happen zechus of them, that zeya could actually be mechaber. Now, it doesn't mean that it's always yatzeledes. If it's a small pot, the zeya that till it reaches there is usually not yatzeledes. You can hold your hand there. You can hold your hand there. But if it's a tall, tall pot and it's very close to that, it's mamish yatzeledes. And when it's yatzeledes, you have really this serious shaila. We should know that there's a whole discussion about zeya when zeya is outside of a pot. Because, or when a pot is open. The halacha Shechen Aruch is in Siman Tzadik Gimel and in Yeredeya. The halacha is that if one puts in a spoon into a pot and a milchige spoon into a fleshige pot, so you need to have shishim kineget whatever went into the soup. Then you need kineget the whole spoon. Those don't say chamuk tzasi chamkulo legab this. And therefore, you only need shishim kineget or touched the soup. Veta shailan de achreinam, Prima Godem and others are all discussion in what's doing with the zeya. There's zeya on top of above. So some want to say that that's included in the soup. Others say no, that's not included in the soup. It says only masha nitchaf, the teicha gdeida. And what's because this zeya is like an open zeya. An open zeh is not concentrated. A lav dafke, it's yatzeledes. So the case of the machvas, with the Alter Rebbe talks, we're putting into a closed tanir. You're putting one machvas below another pot in a closed tanir. That zeh has a connection. It's mamish mechuber, it's yatzeledes, and it's enclosed. However, when you have an open pot and there is a hood, and you uncover the pot and zeh goes all over, so even if the Alter Rebbe holds that zeya is mechaber mamish, Shaila Siddur is Zeich Machaber, but the Evet, if the Shaila happened and one forgot to cover the hood with silver foil, should ask a Shaila if the Evet did Aser his pots. It's impossible to kasher the hood. The hood is full of Shmutz Be'ein in the fan inside. You know, it's very difficult to say that we could kasher that. So one needs to do is one needs to cover it. And you cover it with two covers with two silver foils. Now, what happens, you know, if you need to use that? You need to use the fan to pull out all the vapors from the home, and you need to, when you cook it gets very hot, you need to pull it out. So what I did in my home sometimes, that this is the hood of this, let's say this, if you look at this top, this is the hood. So I put a foam plate or a plastic bowl, which is 2-3 inches thick, and then I made underneath a few layers of covering of silver foil from the back, and I left the front open, but the silver foil goes a little further than the pots, further than the gas stove. And therefore now, if the fan pulls any heat, there's no direct zeya going up, because direct zeya will touch silver foil, will not touch the fan. But when the fan goes up, it pulls air from the whole room. It will include, pull some zeya, like in a roundabout way. And I don't think in such a way we could say that this zeya is mechubar and it will aser the pot while it's pulling that away. And I don't think, if it's not oila directly above, it's for sure not yatzi ledis anymore while it goes around. So if this is the hood, I put something, you could make any kind of gadget you want. I put something in between. And I first I covered all around and I opened just where the fan is, where the pulling power is. And then I put something there, it shouldn't block it, it should have some air, and cover over this also with silver foil so the fan could run. However, there's no direct zeya that could go up because it's all covered with silver foil. And the air could only go around, it could be, it's being pulled in by going around that plate or that bowl that I put there. So that is an important halacha. So the ketchila for sure, one has to make sure, and so too the walls. The one behind the stove, that becomes very hot as well. And again, would the Alter Rebbe say that Zeya that goes sideways, that touched sideways, didn't go direct up, is that also a chibur? It's a shayla. So that, for sure, it has to be covered. So too we didn't mention when we kashered the countertops, that also the backsplash should be kashered with at least the irui. Over there, we don't have a chashash usually that a piece of kugel is stuck to it or something, but an irui could happen, a spritz should be done with the irui if possible. And if not, certainly we should also cover it anyway. We should cover it because pots touch it the whole year round, chametz touches the back, and therefore if there's a shayla, the kashering should always be covered, and then we have no shayla when it comes that chalila, if something touched, there it's covered, and also you did some kind of a hagala on that. Talking about the halacha of zeya, there's a halacha which is very similar to that, but the opposite. Statement of the day in Siman Kufei, an interesting halacha. And the Alter Rebbe also brings it in Siman Tov Nun Aleph, in Hilchos Pesach. One is not allowed, l'kitchila, to pour from kosher food on top of a neir shel chelev. The olden days they had chelev, which chelev was mutar b'hanah. They used it, they needed lamps, they didn't have electricity, so they used all kinds of fats. So they used the chelev for candles. It made some shilas here and there because chelev is treif, but it's just mutar b'hanah. So they used it for candles. So that you shouldn't pour oil onto it while it's burning. And the Alter Rebbe explains it, the Prima Godam explains it, that the hevel of the fire would go into the nitzuk. It's kind of a connection. It's not just the zeya itself. Because if it be the zeya itself, you can't hold even a pot above it. You know, there's no real zeya yet. It's a flame. There's no zeya there. It's a flame. And if you hold it on top, which is not yatzaledas, there's no iser. But while you're pouring, you're getting a nitzuk. Even though we know nitzuk ain't a chibur, over here, a lekit chila dikedin. But the abbot doesn't answer. It's a lekit chila dikedin of nitzuk chibur. That the havel will come, it will create a havel, and this the zeya will go into the nitzuk, and this will make a lekit chila dikedin connection. So, but the Rebbe says that's why some people have a minik, that when you kasher with the pot, even the pot that you poured over the hot water, the hot stone, you shouldn't use on Pesach. Even though we explain that it's not barnat, it's nice and tam lavgam, you didn't use the pot for 24 hours, the chometz, the counter wasn't used for 24 hours, it doesn't ask. It's just still a minik, that the keli that you kasher with, you don't use on Pesach, or you kasher it again for Pesach. So the Alter Rebbe says the minik is not only in the keli where you kasher stuff in it, but the minik is even a keli that you poured over the stone because of this chumrah, of this nitzuk, which a chumrah, even though in the day it says clearly the gabachel of mamish, which is Eser Kardes, over there it says, but the abbot it doesn't ask it, it's a lekhil dikedin. Gabba Pesach, there's a minuk, we can chila not to use that keli because the nitzuk went up. So why am I saying this halacha? Besides what there's a minig not to use the keli that we kashered with. Besides that, it is because what happens if we live in an apartment building and there are many goyim and they use hot water on Pesach. The hot water comes all from one boiler and it divides into different pipes and different scenarios. And at the same time, I'm using my hot water over my kosher of food, yeah. So if nitzik chibur, the heat goes back up. If it's a hot pot, especially if it's a hot pot that has its own heat, it's a klirishon, and you pour water on it, hot water. So it makes the nitzik chibur going back, and like it chila, it's machaber now, and he is also pouring hot water over chametz, over treifus or chametz. And therefore, that nitzik chibur goes in, so to speak, into the boiler, for where we both mix together. It's a chumrah, but on Pesach we have all kinds of chumras. So I've famously saw people who live in apartment buildings. At least I remember from where I grew up in Williamsburg that those who lived in apartment buildings did not want to use hot water from the sink on Pesach. Even though they kashered the faucet and everything, they didn't want to use for that reason. Even though nobody went to the boiler and baked chametz in the boiler, nobody put chametz in the boiler. However, mitzad din of nitzik chibur, this is what the Alter Rebbe just said, that not to use even a keli that you kashered with because of this chumrah. So they don't want to use so this keli. But if a person lives in a private home and he kashered the sink properly and he kashered it well, and he kashered the faucet where it's coming out, one could make such a chumrah and say that the nitzig went back into the boiler and you can't go kasher there. One should ask his shayla is rough if he wants to have this chumrah. I think most people do it once they kasher the kran, the faucet very well, and the sink very well, then they do use the hot water in Pesach. And the fact that there was this chibur, this was before Pesach, and now you kashered the sink, and it's nice and tam l'vgam, and the whole thing was only a chumre din l'kit chila of nitzik chibur. There is a halacha, the Beis Yosef, the Machaber brings a halacha in Simet Tzadik Dalet, on Tzadik He or Tzadik Dalet, I think, in Yeredeya. The Machaber says an interesting halacha. Nidoli, he says his own chiddush. It sounds like what we have today, the jet age, that you could speed up things which used to take longer times. Now we make it in seconds. And the Machaber came up with such a concept. Usually to make something nice and tamlif gam, a pot, you have to wait 24 hours, called Eina Bin Yema. It takes 24 hours to become Eina Bin Yema, MS less. However, the Machaber says yearly that if somebody cooks a pot and puts afer, ashes into the water, which has a very bad taste, and you cook it, it ruins the taste in the pot itself. It ruins all the blias, and it turns the blias into noisen tam lifgam, which is the chiddush of the Beis Yosef, that you could make actually something instead of waiting 24 hours, you could make it noisen tam lifgam right away. Based on this, today you don't have to have afer. Today we have all kinds of agents, pneumonia and other different sharp agents that will ruin the taste of chemicals, which will ruin taste of things. However, the Shach and the Taz bring rias against this mechaber, the dingins of them, it's not so posh, we could make a taste in a pot. Leisen tam of gamla of dafke, Chazal didn't say that. They have rias from tastes and other places. We don't rely on this. But the avid, this is used many times. If somebody washed dishes and the goya washed dishes and you find the milch is spoon between flesh to your left leg, the Rav will first ask Shiloh, the first Shiloh will be, is the goya using gloves? In other words, is the hot water so hot that she can't put her hand in there? Or is the water not so hot in the first place that she's washing it usually with regular hands? Then it's not Yatzalenus. And if it is very hot, then did she put first soap in all the dishes that are in the sink? Or she pours first soap and they're soaking there. Soap makes the same thing, the same as Afer. Nobody will eat and drink from that water, which soap is in there. So that also makes nice in Tam of Gamsa. But the Evet, it will be used to be mattered, the city of there wasn't so hot, and so on and so forth. So I know for a fact that every Balmachshir, when they take over a hotel to kasher for a simcha, for a chasen, and so on and so forth, they try very much to make sure that a set of dishes that they're going to use is put away and sealed from the night before, 24 hours before they start kashering. They take over things the day before. Many, many times it's not shayach. The hotel keeper will promise you to give you this. It's not shayach. They had that day another event before. It's very difficult. So even those caterers who swear to you and promise that they waited 24 hours before they started kashering, it's not always shayach. So they rely on a certain heter. They kasher everything with ammonia water. They make a mixture of water and ammonia, and they kasher boiling hot water. They throw in the dishes and everything with ammonia water. And they do the dual thing. At the same time, they accomplish making it 24 hours based on this mechaber. So that's, of course, it's not l'kitchila because the paskim are chilek in that, but sometimes there's no breda. We're stuck. They don't have shishim, as we mentioned in the first shir. So if you don't have shishim, and we're talking about isur mamish, that you don't have nat barnat, as mentioned in the first year, because it's isur. So how do you kasher? The bliya comes out, it goes right back in. You need to have nois and tam levgam in order that the kasher and the hagola should work. And therefore they do that. They mix with ammonia water, and then they kasher. But since it says in Shulchan Aruch that we don't know how other agents, how other liquids work, we only know what Chazal told us. According to many Rishonim, you can only kasher dafke with water. You can't use any other mashke. But this is a kind of a mixture with other mashkoyes. Ammonia is not water. And therefore, they kasher it twice. They make two runs. One run of kashering is with ammonia water, and they assume that that makes everything nice and tam of gam. It makes it ain't a vinyayman. And then they run a second kashering, which is just simple plain water. And that it's as if it's already after the 24 hours, and by now it's ain't a binyan. Of course, yeah, everybody should ask the Shaila Rav, if you go to Ukraine, you get there Erev Pesach, and that's a Shaila many Bacharim and many Shluchim have. You get there, it's impossible to get there earlier, they won't give it to you. And it's Erev Pesach, and that's when you start doing your things. How can you cash it? So if it's only a Shaila of Chomer, it's much lighter. If it's before the Zman Isser, and it's much easier because there's the shittas of a teirubala, and it makes it easier. And by the way, the Alter Rebbe says that when you have gimel nois and tam, that you can be makel by chometz, that it's called not banat lehateira. In other words, you're kashering a pot before shochamishes, when chometz is still heter gomer. So when you kasher, so it works, you have three nois and tams over here. The chametz, which went in originally into the pot, that's tam rishon. From the pot, it goes into the water that you kasha, that's tam sheni, and it still had to, chametz is still mutter. And even though the Alter Rebbe says we are machmir that chametz is not called a teira bala, however, says the Alter Rebbe, when it becomes gimel noisen tam, now this water will go back into a pot, not into food, back into a pot. It's so weak that we make legab chametz before shachamish, before the iser that it's considered a teira bala, and therefore you could kasher without waiting 24 hours. However, the minig is we always wait 24 hours anyway before we kasher. But if one runs into such a problem, shliach gets to a place and he needs, has 200 people and needs to kasher tons of stuff now. So if he starts before this man is said, then you could kasher regular if it's a kasher place. If it's a treif place, you're not dealing with chametz, you're dealing with nevelus and treifus. So then you need 24 hours. So then the only other breda is either to rely on the ammonia water, as I said, you want to ask Shaila Rav. Or the other eight says you do libunkal. Libunkal, you don't need to wait 24 hours. You take a torch. If you have metallic surfaces and all the other stuff, you could actually take even dishes and put into an oven. Yeah, they might get a drop discolored. You have to be very careful when it gets too hot. But you could do dishes and put it into a pan, spread them out, and get the heat up very high. And it's called the libunkal. If it makes us heat to the other side, becomes either kash nisrevad yatsa or yatsa ledes. You know, then you could do libun kal. Libun kal could always be done, and you don't need the 24 hours. So behemshach to what we said before, that the minig is that we don't use the minig is that we kasher kelim again if we want to use them before Pesach, even though the bliya didn't go back and it was kosher the way we explained. So the Alter Rebbe says in Siman Tafnun and Beis Sif Chav Beis, the Alter Rebbe says that Aval Nahagu Lahachmir Velachzer Lahagi Layere Acharegolus Kelim Beteichek Kedelish Tamash Bebe Pesach Af Im Loi Hoyu Akelim Bnei Yemen, even if everything you kashed was not Bnei Yemen, in Vegilim Beteichem Koidim Shahei, if you, even if you did it before the Isser, Vegama Yere Lehoisa Basyeme, and even the Yere itself was not a Basyeme, the meaning is that you recasher the keli that you used for kashering, you recasher before you want to use it for Pesach. And the Alter Rebbe also, it's at the meaning, it says, V'chein ha'aga, this is, I'm quoting now from Sif Tazvav and Tafnun Beis. וכל זה מעיקר הדין, אבל כבר נהגה במדינה סיילו להחמיר להגה לידה תחילה, אף אם אין לבס ימה, אם אגל בתכי קודם שוהי. This is, before we were talking about after kashering. Now we're talking before kashering. If the keli is a chametz dikki keli that you're going to kasher in it, we first kasher that keli. A minik. וכן נהגה שלו להגה על שום keli כשהיא בן ימה, we never magel, we don't kasher any keli which is a בן ימה, Afshehu yechidi, even though it's only one, and it's a small spoon. And v'yesh b'mayim yoyser misamach kinegdoi. So for sure it's going to work because it's going to be bottled b'shishim. And v'afilo reitzel agili koidim shahei. So you have two kulos now. You have shishim kinegdoi. And it's koidim shahei. It's not barnat. The bliya will come out and go back in and it's still heter. Nevertheless, lo yagilenu kishahu ben yoymei. Gezeir. The minig is also gezeir shem yitu. Will make a toys lahagel kela blue and mishari sudutoyrik shibin yemen. People are not lamdonim, and they won't make be mechalag between chametz and other isurim, or between fleishig and milchik. And sometimes you kasher fleishig and milchig kelim. And therefore, and v'lo yedagdeku im yesh b'mayim samach kinegdo v'yachzeru amayim v'yivlu b'keli. And v'yasro isim, it's going to be also remain samach kinegdo. Shalai inka noisim tam noisim tam shal heter. And therefore, this is the minik, and therefore, this is our minik that we always kasher the keli that we want to kasher in it. No, I'm sorry. Yeah, we always. No, I'm sorry. The minik is that we never magil a keli unless it's ena bin yame, regardless whether it's shishim or not shishim. What I mentioned before was in a shasat chak when you get to a place and it's not shayach and you have 100 people for the seder, what do you do? So then you're going to have to ask a Shaila Arav, you know, that you're not going to be able to follow this minik But the halacha, now you have to know very well the halacha. When can you rely, even though it's a ben yema, or you need the efer and so on and so forth. The Alter Rebbe says in Siman Tov Nun Beis, Siv Chav Zayin, Chame Teveria, Dine Ke Chame Ho'er, but only Lahachmir. Ke Goyen Le Nyebliya, that it becomes Osir, Shem Nishtamash Isur Bekli, Ayidei Chame Teveria, is Nesar HaKli, and it needs to kasha it. Aval Ein Magilim B'Toicham Kelim Shenesar Al Dei Chame Ho'er, but you can't kasha it in its things which became Osir through Chame Ho'er, Afilu Le Nesar El Al Dei Chame Klishen. Even why? Because Chame Teveria is not told us oir. And Kvar Omru, Kabaloi, Kach Polte. It's a different type of heat. It's a different type of nature. And Mamele, it's not going to come out only through Tuldus oir. Anything which is heated up through the Isser went in through regular fire heat needs to come out through that type. But something which became Osir through Chame Teveria, that you could kasher through Chame Teveria. And the Alter Rebbe adds, "V'kolshkin al yidei chama oir," which is interesting, that even though we don't say na kabbalah kachpolte, fire, regular fire, which Chazal told you to do a hagolah with, that always works. That will work even for chama teveria. We don't say, well, it has to be kabbalah kachpolte. If that's a different nature of heat, then the fire, the regular fire, shouldn't be able to take that out. We don't say that. But the opposite we say, that you cannot kasher with Chame Teveria something which became us at a regular fire. Where is this negeia to us today? We don't live in Eretz Yisrael, we're not next to Chame Teveria. Bechura, what I'm thinking is a microwave. If somebody heats up a bowl of water in a microwave, even to the extent that the bowl of water starts bubbling, Maila Babuis, bubbles, you cannot use that keli now with that hot water to kasher, let's say, a table that we do iru klirishon on it with that keli. Why? Because this was not heated up through regular fire. It's heated up to a mechanism which excites the molecules in the water and they have friction and they become very hot because they have friction in there, but there's no fire in there. And therefore, it's not called toldus oir. If one might ask a question, if that's the case, then how can we use electricity? As we mentioned, you know, we could use an iron as called chameh oyer, like a even meluben. There's no fire. And the answer is that when something bursts into flames, I don't care what material made the flame. Is it gasoline? Is it wood? Is it coals? As long as it's a physical fire, that a gashmi is that you think is burning wood or any other thing. And so too the Rambam says, when a gacheles, when a piece of metal turns into a gacheles, it becomes red hot, that's ash. That's like a piece of wood burning. Now I don't care which scientific way it happened, because the molecules and the metal, because of the electrons that ran in too many of them, and therefore it couldn't contain, and it became so hot that it started to glow. The bottom line is, once it glows, it's fire. The Rambam says a glowing metal is fire. That's Tuldus Oir. As opposed to molecules of water, when they rubbed each other and they became so hot because of the microwaves, and therefore they start to bubble because of the heat, we don't have fire here. So we don't have a Tuldus Oir. We have hot water. That's exactly the Chame Teveria. And therefore that you cannot use to kasher the table. L'chura, that's how I think. If you want to kasher something in a microwave with that, for example, which we didn't discuss it because it's complicated, but to those who want to be maker, when you kasher for a person starting to become frum and he doesn't want to give away his microwave, so some people are maker to put a bowl of water in there and let the microwave heat it up to such an extent that the zeya will go all around, then you move it to 5-6 places, so the original place where it was standing is also now kashered. For those who want to be makel with that, you'll ask it off. But if that's the this shaila that we just had, mitzat chame teveria, is not a problem, because you're kashering a microwave, which all the heat that was over there, ever applied there, you don't take hot stuff, you put it in there. All the heat, that anything which is heated up in that is usually from the microwave itself. So it's kasher in chametz averi with chametz averi. That's okay. Yeah. But to use it for outside, that is my shaila, whether one can do it. Probably not. The way you kasher a pot. Now, a pot in regular circumstances, the iser goes in from the inside. You cook inside. Some of it spills over here and there. So therefore, it says in the halacha, the way you kasher a pot is you fill it up with hot water. For states of the halacha, you wait 24 hours, 100% clean, v'chulu. You fill it up with hot water. Then you heat up a stone and you throw a hot stone in it. That will make the bubbles go crazy and just boil over. It seems like you could actually, I would think you could do it also with a cold piece of metal, but that would cool off the water, so it's not boiling anymore when it goes over. You just pushed it out. I'm not sure if it's boiling. But if you do it, that's how the Shulchan Aruch says, if you do it with a hot stone or a hot piece of metal, it runs over not only because you displaced water by pushing in something, because it got so hot that it boils over. And therefore, that kashers the walls from the outside. We assume that whatever spilled before and the blias came went in from the outside, this will now be kashered from the outside as well. But if something became usher from the very outside, then l'chura, this won't work. Because a pot that we kitchil, it's not just it spilled over a little bit here and there, so you can assume this spill will do the same thing. But if the belias went in from the outside, lamashal, you washed a keli in a dishwasher together by mistake with milchi yekelim and fleshi yekelim together, or chametz, which is schmutz outside, and the hot water comes from the outside, lekitchila all around, then such a thing needs to be kashered from the inside out from the regular way. It needs to be put into a bigger keli, which the bigger keli has boiling water. It has to be kashered. The inside and the outside has to be kashered normal, because the Alter Rebbe says hesek pinim. From where the food went in, that's where the regular hagala has to be. And if the whole iser came in from the outside as well, you need to kasher from the outside as well. Just we should know that many pots have a little rim on top. And that fancy rim has a little space in there which schmutz goes in. You'll see your mother many times trying to clean the pot, takes a toothpick and kratzes around, all around. It's full of schmutz. A be'ein cannot be kashered. It blocks, makes the iser again. So therefore, it says, Shulchan Aruch, a place where you cannot get in there to clean it out thoroughly cannot be kashered. And the eighth of Shulchan Aruch, it says when a keli has cracks, that you have to put gecholim. On that spot, you have to put gecholim to burn it away. So today you can take a toothpick, clean it out as much as you can, try until the toothpick comes out clean, but it's not 100% clean inside, you can't get in there. But then you take a torch, or if you don't have a torch, you can actually take the pot, put the rim on the flame of the stovetop, and keep it on that spot for four or five seconds, and you know, it should be really getting really burned away, and then turn to the next spot, then turn to the next spot, then turn to the next spot, go all around, and that's how you kasher make sure of that be'ain is burned away, and then you kasher the pot in a regular way. Yeah. Some people, once they get to this, they try and you could get away with that. You could take the pot, turn it upside down onto a stovetop, and the lahav, the fire will really really burn it out to such a way it's going to become libun kal. But then again, this is only from the inside. You have to do the same thing all around, and from the outside to do a libun kal. A libun kal has the same thing as a hagola. If you made it so hot that the other side became very very hot. As we say, either kashnisru or yatzaledas, depending. And then the halacha is that you could kasher that way. Now, what's doing with the handles? It says in Shulchan Aruch that a knife you can't kasher because between the handle and the lahav, the blade, there's a crack and schmutz goes in there. So if it's wood, Shulchan Aruch says you can't kasher because you're going to burn the wood. If you don't care, you could actually take a torch and burn out where the crack is. Then you could kasher. That's true. And Shulchan Aruch doesn't say that because the other sakela are usually made out of wood. You're going to ruin it. But if one wants to do that, you could do that. But what do we do with a pot that has handles? They're screwed on. So of course, one has to unscrew it, clean it out thoroughly, and then that's how you kash it. Now, the yodei sakelim are made out of plastic. Plastic is a big machlekes in achreinim. Some bring raya's this way, raya's that way. Can you kash it? Can you not kash it? So the maise is as the maise is that plastic, most achreinim accept that if you cooked in it in a klirishin, then it should not be kashered. So therefore, let's say a Teflon pot, which is a plastic, which is a type of a material which didn't exist in the Mechazal, one cannot kash. Besides what 90% of the cases of Teflon is usually used for a frying pan, and a frying pan, as we mentioned already in the earlier shiurim, that if it's only smeared with a little bit of shemen, that's called regular afia, and that's not even called tigun, and then it needs libun. Once you put fire, libun gomer, to this, the whole Teflon comes off, the whole thing is garbage, it's ruined. You can't kash it then, because you need libun. But the handles, if they're made out of plastic, so it says in Moriktsio from the Yavetz, that he says that if you cooked in a keli, let's say somebody made a mistake, it's like somebody called me yesterday with the Shaila, that he prepared kreplach for Erev Yom Kippur a few months before, put it in the freezer, and Erev Yom Kippur, they wanted to heat it up. You know, but before putting it into the soup, they decided, you know what, let's just warm it up in water. And then they wanted to send it to a few of their kids. And they did so. They took a pot and they put in the kreplach to heat it up when it was boiling hot. And then Mamish Menas Shemaim and Nes Menas Shemaim, they realized they made a mistake. You know, there's such a thing as Milchigi kreplach. Labav, which we don't know so much about that, but in the Ungarish, there's such a thing as Shavua, is they eat Milchigi kreplach. It looks exactly the same. It's a dough that has in it, instead of flesh, it has cheese in it. This was a fleshige pot with milchige kreplach in it. Yeah? So the shaila now, how do you kasher this pot? So the blias, says the Moirik Tzia, didn't go into the handle of the klal. Why? Because the klal is, ein blia heilich mikeli al keli b'loy reitav. In this case, the whole issue went in from the inside. It wasn't in a dishwasher. It wasn't that the handles touch stuff. The whole shaila, how the handle became asr, is a one-time thing. We knew it had to go through the pot. But ein bli ha'elach mikeli on keli b'leiretiv. So the handles didn't become a chlal asr. However, there's shmutz there. There's something in there, and that shmutz touched the pot, like a tipas chalav. That shmutz could become asr. So you have to take apart the handles, clean it out thoroughly, and you kasher the pot. And if you want to kasher the handles as well, fine. But in this case, we're not going to say that you can't kasher because it's plastic. But if you put in a pot into a dishwasher and the shaila happened in the dishwasher, which the shaila happened on the handles themselves, then one should ask it off a shaila. I don't know, maybe people are going to be makel today on these handles. And it depends for what. For example, if you're going to be cooking in the pot, it's not going to be a big shaila because then again, even if the handles were not 100% kosher, no blia will come back from that into the pot. But how are you going to wash it in the sink together tomorrow with reitav in a dishwasher, where there the handles with the pot will all become one? So one should ask Yishayla, if the a pot became osir and the handles were involved as much, then how do you kosher that? So I want to finish off with the last sif of the Alter Rebbe Siman Tov Nun Beis Sif Lamed, and he says, "Lefi sherabu ha'moed hadikdukim." You know what? Before we finish off that, I forgot to say another important halacha, which is when we kasher many kelim, when you put in 5 spoons, it stops bubbling because the metal cools it off, and the Alter Rebbe says it must be ma'ila babuis, and therefore you must stop. You could actually take them out, and those you could cool off already. But if the last spoon, which cooled off the bubbling, you must wait till the water starts bubbling again before you put any more additional kalim in to this. There's also one halacha that we didn't mention, Bariches, the halacha of a ladle. In Yiddish called a sheplefel. You put a ladle into a keli, and you take out hot water. That's a big machlekes apaska, whether this is now called a klidishin or a klisheni. Because the tfanois of this is similar to klisheni. These tfanois were never heated up on the fire. They just went in for 1 second into this big pot. And therefore, you take out the water, even if the water is bubbling, you can't kasher with it. L'chumre, it does not have a din of a klidishin. In other words, the kasher, you can't be makel that this is a klidishin. L'chumre, it asers. But to say that you could kasher from this, or put something into this, now it's going to be called a klidishin, you cannot do that. Unless you let it in, you left it inside until the water started boiling, while you look into the ladle and the water boils, you know, you left it there for a while and the water started boiling in there, because then the tfanis itself became heated up from the fire like the original pot. But otherwise, you can't kasher through a ladle. Also, when one has many kalim, as we mentioned by one of the shurim already before, when you put many kalim, besides what you have to be careful that the water should bubble, when you put many, many more kalim, tzir comes out, a lot of juices come out, and then the water becomes thickened. It becomes a different texture altogether. It's not like water. Then one must change that water, and one should not kasher with that water further. It's interesting that the Alter Rebbe says in Sif Chav Ches, one is not allowed to kasher with shar mashkin. And so too, the Alter Rebbe mentions if it's mixed with efer, has a din of shar mashkin. So the ammonia water we mentioned before has a din shar mashkin. You can't kasher with that by itself. But the efer is mevatel koyach hamayim. But the Alter Rebbe says b'di'evet that you use that or shar mashkin, the hagola is kosher. B'di'evet, it's kosher. But in Sif Chav Tes, the Alter Rebbe says in higul har bekelim b'yoyre, at shemeroif pleites hakelim naso hamayim kitzir, they become thick, ein lahagloid b'yisan hamayim. Alter Rebbe doesn't say osir, it says ein lahagel. It doesn't say b'di'evet if you did this kosher mistaber, that's better than shar mashkin, it's of course of water. Mistaber as b'di'evet if you did it, it's impossible to be lenit noteri lamlachi asharis. At which point do we say, it became tzir. And so one keli before is still mutter, and the next keli is asir. Fashteitzach b'di'evet, mistaber that it's mutter. But when you see it starting to get tzir, one should change the water. I remember I saw once Mariches years ago a shayla on many chocolates, that they say that many chocolates that says that it's parif or chalav Yisrael. He says you can have a shayla on that because no machinery that you make chocolate on it. And again, I'm not a chroy on this. I remember what I read maybe by Blumenkrantz once, by others saw them. This is just as an interesting thing, not Lamaisa, that they say that you can't kasher a chocolate machine with water. It breaks the machine. They're not allowing any water coming in there. So how do they kasher? They make a run between the treif, or the non-chalav Yisrael, between the treif chocolate and the kasher chocolate. They make another run that they watch. That run they don't sell to Yidden. That run they sell to the goyim. That run is the kashering for the next run. And that's how it was kashered, through chocolate. Now, with the evet, I have to think, is melted chocolate the din of shar mashkin? And at least with the evet, it's kosher. Like the for sure, one shouldn't rely on such a thing. Is it kosher with the evet? But I guess bedatz gives ashgacha, and others were talking erlach harabanim. So I don't know. Maybe it's not true, this fact. Maybe they do kosher with water. But I just threw it in as an interesting fact, discussing this halacha of mashke and tzir. The Alter Rebbe finishes off in Sif Lamed, L'fisha Rabu Me'oita Dikduke Me'ilchas Hagala, as you realize how many halachas is negay over here. In the Ein Hakel Bekiyim Behen, L'fisha Rau V'nochen Shebal Teira Habaki Me'ilchas Hagala, that it should be a Baal Teira, somebody who's Baki in Hilchas Hagala, who Yagilas HaKelem. He should be the one who is Magil the Kelem. V'loi Kemoshin Hagin Achshav, says the Alter Rebbe. Apparently there was a minik. That Noshim, whatever, anytime you had a Shaila, Noshim would kasher their own things. Noshim are involved in everything when it comes to Zalz the Flesh. They knew better than the men. And they knew many halachas when it came to run a kitchen. That's their department. So apparently when a Shaila happened, they also kashered. Yeah, but Alter Rebbe says, no, that is more complicated than the daily things they know how to do. They're better than other people. But when a shayla comes up, that's not a daily thing, how to kasha. One should get a boki, a Tom Chacham, to tell him how to do this hagala. And the Rebbe says, I'll help him to chlen and hilchis hagala. And so when zeichas am bekarif to the geula, I always go for the geul from Mitzrayim, and I then go in the migoilel the geula bekarif mamish, and I send the geula shleima bekarif mamish.